Good morning, Miss Kenya. How are you? Good morning, Miss Lana. Happy Mother's Day. Good morning, preacher. Happy Mother's Day. Good morning. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? Good morning, brother. How are you? Good to see you. Good morning, Deke. How are you, brother? Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, Kendrick. What's happening, bro? Good morning, Lawrence. What's going on? What's going on? Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers. Happy Mother's Day to you. Good morning. Tell Xavier, I said, what's happening? Good morning, Miss Shaquana. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day, everybody. Good morning, Miss Sargis. Good morning, Clarence. How are you? Good morning, Miss Lauren. Preacher. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day, cuz. Happy Mother's Day. Everybody's doing good, doing well, better than ever. Good morning. Good morning, First Lady. All right. I will trust in thank you, Lawrence. I appreciate you. Appreciate you. Good morning, daughter. You guys can go ahead and share this video. Good morning, Reverend Flowers.
That's right.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, son. Who is the everlasting? Oh, you are the everlasting. Good morning, Miss Wanda. How are you? Good morning, Miss Monica. God bless you. Good morning, Bishop Brown. How you doing, brother? Who is the everlasting God? You are the everlasting God. You are the everlasting God. You said I hope on you. You said I hope on your love. You said I hope on the world. Who is the everlasting God? Good morning, Auntie. Alright. I think we're getting there. Glad you guys could get on this morning. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. Pray that everything is going well with you. Today's a beautiful day. Praise God. Beautiful day. Beautiful day. In a few more minutes, seconds for people to get on, and we'll get right to it. We'll get right to this word this morning. Praise God. Good morning, Mr. Center. Good morning, Ms. Bellman.
Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to everyone. Praise God. Good morning, Miss King. Good morning, Miss Pat. Praise God. Happy Mother's Day. Good morning, Miss Topsy. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. Praise God. Good morning, Miss Sabrina, wife of the bishop. Happy Mother's Day to you. I pray that everybody's doing well. I pray that God is blessing you. You woke up this morning with life, health, and strength. Amen. That's reason enough right there to give God praise. But we are thankful for this time we have together. This aspect of our ministry is probably going to come to a close within the next couple of weeks as they are opening the doors back to the church. Praise God. Now that it will be out of sight maybe, but not out of mind. I thank God for the time that we've had. I cherish the time that we'll have going forward until they decide to let us back into the doors of the church. And even then, we'll be live, but you guys will probably be in your own ministries at that point. So we thank God for this time. Thank God for each and every one of you. Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers. Pray that you have a wonderful, rest-filled, blessed with heaven's best today. So we're going to go right into the Word. We're going to pray and get into the Word. Hope you didn't log on expecting a Mother's Day message because that's not what God gave me. My assignment is to continue to give us instructions, to give us our food for thought as we are preparing for what's next in the church. So that is my assignment. That is where we'll be going from here until we get back. And even when we get back, I don't know that I'll be necessarily preaching holiday messages. If that's not what the Lord gives me, I'm going to try my best to stay in communication and tune with God to only preach and teach what He tells me, gives me instructions to do so. So we do. We thank God for this time. And if you don't mind, let's go right into the Word of God. I'm going to be talking to you today from Exodus chapter 6. I'm going to read verses 6, 7, and 8, but our text is going to come from Exodus 6, verses 1 through 8, and then chapter 14, verses 15 and 16, just to bring it all to a close. But I'm going to read Exodus chapter 6, verses 6, 7, and 8. It says, "Therefore, say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will rescue you from their bondage, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm with great judgments. I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will bring you into the land which I swore to give to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I will give to you as a heritage. I am the Lord." Praise God. That is an excerpt from Egypt, Exodus, as they are preparing to Exodus out of Egypt. Praise God. And these are instructions to speak to the children of Israel as they are about to go forward. They're about to Exodus out of Egypt. God wanted them to know some particulars before they actually left up out of Egypt. So we're going to be talking today, going from wilderness into worship. And for my thought of birthing your prophecy, that some of you have prophecies that have been indelibly engrafted into your life, and you may be struggling with how to birth the prophecy. We're going to give instructions and talk a little bit today about exodusing from wilderness into worship and how to birth our prophecies. We can't make the prophecy come to pass, but we can birth out the prophecy through a process that God has given to us. And as we are preparing to go into what's next, it's going to be vital and necessary that we birth out the gifts and the callings of God and the prophecies spoken and prayed over our lives in this next move. So in our text, let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time. We ask you to maximize this time and speak to us out of the volume of your holy book, words of life, clarity, authority, and conviction. Father God, we stand at the ready to receive your word today. Hide me behind that old rugged cross, Father God. I decrease that you will increase until there's no more I, only the Christ that's on the inside. Have your way. We'll be careful to give your name the glory, honor, and all the praise because you alone are worthy. Speak to us in this time we have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Praise God. So in our text today, we are getting a glimpse of the power of the prophetic voice of God. Every time God speaks, beloved, it is prophetic, and God's prophecies are full, factual, fervent, and full of favor. God has spoken some things over your lives that must come to pass in the near future. And as they come to pass, we will be essentially proving the word of God to be true and every man that comes against the word of God as a liar. When God speaks, though, he speaks generationally. He speaks to certain things that will happen in our lifespan, but he also speaks generationally because there are certain things that will happen in this next move in when our children ascend into ministry. So when God speaks, he's speaking according to his purpose and his plan, not necessarily in the now. Okay. Now, as God's plan begin to unfold in our lives, we must understand that there are going to be forces coming against what God has spoken. You must make a decision that you are going to live out what God says and not what the enemy has said. You must make a decision that what God said about you is true and that you are going to go hard in the paint for what God says until you actually see the fruit and the fervency of what God has spoken into your life. Now, when we start talking about the promised land, everybody wants to go. When we start talking about the promises of God and the healing power and the miracles of God, everybody wants to be there. In our text, when Moses started preaching and prophesying about the promised land flowing with milk and honey to a group of slaves, they wanted to go. But when they started out in the process, they found out, they came to realize you cannot just go from slavery to success without suffering. Mm. You can't just go from slavery to success without a modicum of suffering and without going through the proper process. The road from slavery to success is a powerful yet painstaking process. Here lies the problem with the prophecies that is always accompanied by pain. That when you receive the prophecy, that you don't always hear about the pain associated with birthing out a promise or a prophecy from God. Walking out the prophecy of God is not always going to be easy because you have to deal with the threats of Pharaoh, fear, and failure. I'll say that again. Walking out the prophecies of God is not going to be easy. Birthing out this prophecy is not going to be easy because you have to deal with the threats of Pharaoh, fear, and failure. But number one, you have to understand that pain awakens power, but prophecy awakens authority. There is a difference between power and authority. This is what the children of Israel had to come to realize, is that they were always powerful, but the prophecy awakened their authority. The pain of the children of Israel they endured woke up the power in them. Being enslaved for 400 plus years woke up the power that the children of Israel had. In fact, the Egyptians only enslaved them because they realized more than the children of Israel the power that they had. Even though there was a small group and there were some in that group that kept complaining, it did not negate the power of the word of God. If you don't learn how to deal with your pain, then your prophecy will never come to pass. There's pain associated with prophecy. So when God moves, he moves you out of slavery. But watch this, to come out of slavery is to come out of your safe place. To come out of your safe place is to come into a level of uncomfortability. To come into that place is to realize that your blessing does not reside within your comfort level. And it takes courage to move out of a place you are safe and you are comfortable to move into a level to where you have no precedence for even being there. Sometimes moving from slavery to success, you will be haunted by the voices in your past that saying you might fail or you might fall or you are more comfortable in that place. You might hear the voice of Pharaoh telling you he's going to do to you what he used to do to you. There is no fear like the fear of the enemy doing an encore in your life. But you've got to know that pain awakens the power that you already had, but prophecy awakens the authority that you need to utilize that power that God has already given you. So when the enemy comes after you, you've got to know what to say. You've got to know the word of God. You've got to understand not to fight him on his level, but fight utilizing the word of God. And you've got to understand what real power is. Real power is only given to those who can handle it. And then he doesn't even give authority until you're at an age where you can appropriate that power. But this is real power, beloved. When you learn to be blessed in the midst of people cursing you, here's real power. When you learn to worship your worries away, here's real power. When you pray until something happens, here's real power. When you pray until something else happens, here is real power. When you praise until you see the promise, here is real power. When you long suffer with the insufferable, here's real power. When you give until you become a giver, when you bless until you become a blesser, when you speak life until you see life, when you extend yourself by your faith until your faith is stretched. Here is real power until you worship even when you don't feel like it. When fear won't leave and you command fear to take up its weapons and flee, because God has given you the authority to walk all over any fear that will reside in your life. Here's real power. When you stop wasting time waiting on the conditions to be right to do what God has told you to do. Let me help you this morning. The conditions will never be right for you to do what God has called you to do. But you've got to lace up your bootstrap. You've got to grab your word. You've got to put tenacity in your spirit and say, I'm going to do the will of God in spite of the circumstances, in spite of the situation, in spite of everything that's going on. Because God has given me power. God has given me authority. God will not waste power or authority on someone that's not willing to leave Exodus or to leave Egypt and Exodus into a promised land. Power is the ability to produce an effect or something in your life. Power is inherent. Authority is the power to influence or command thought, opinion, or behavior. Authority, beloved, is given by God. There was a difference between power and authority, much like the difference between knowledge and wisdom. Power is the ability to move something. Authority is the ability to keep it moved. Power is the ability to move something out of the way. The authority is the ability to look at it and make it stay where you put it. See, God has given you power, but he's also given authority over those things that may be adversarial in your life. You can be powerful, but have no authority. But you cannot have authority and not have power. Man has been given a modest amount of power, but no authority until they accept the finished work of the cross. You can be as powerful as you want to be, but until you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior and get filled with the Holy Spirit and begin to walk in the avenues, realms, and streams that God has called you to walk in, you'll always be full of potential, but never able to release that power. You see, witches and warlocks have power, but they've been given no authority. I'll say that again. Witches and warlocks have power. The soothsayers and the palm readers have power, but they haven't been given authority to exercise. That's why what they do is illegal in the church of the living God. God blesses you and gives you the authority to utilize that power he's given you. Watch this. Balaam tried to curse Israel, but didn't because he couldn't, because he weighed his power against God's authority. So he ended up blessing them because he came to realize you can't curse what God has already blessed. Pharaoh's magicians had power to make a serpent, but God showed them authority when he gave Aaron the power to create another serpent to swallow theirs up. Beloved, when I was young, I was powerful, but I had no authority. But now that I've been through some things, now that I've seen the cycle of life, now I have the authority to add to that power. Now, instead of quoting scripture I really didn't understand, I now quote scripture with the authority, knowing that God honors his word. So now I quote, then I wait. Now I quote, then I wait for the promise of what I quoted. When I was young, I heard about the cross. Now that I'm older, I know about the cross. When I was young, I saw God's power. Now that I'm older, I'm fully convinced of God's power for me, and nothing will be able to separate me from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. So believers, understand that you have power, but God has also given you authority. My second point is power reveals the process. The power he's given you reveals to you a process, oh my God, a process that you must endure in order to get to the promise. Moses was faced with a moment of magnitude where he had to change his focus from complaining to turning. He had to focus on turning to God and not the complaining of the people. He had to stop talking to the people and start talking to God. It takes power to turn from your problem and turn to the process. We need to reopen the lines of communication. The purpose of getting shut in is to reopen the lines of communication so God can show us what's next. You reopen the lines by fasting, prayer, and consecration before God. It takes a while of listening to God to understand and to purge your stinking thinking. It takes a while of listening to God to understand that you got to purge that thought pattern that has taken residence in your life. You've got to hear what God says about you more than once to really understand or embrace what God is really saying to you. Psalm 62 and 11 said, in order for God's word to work in your system, it's got to be reverberated in your system until his word becomes your word, until his thoughts become your thoughts. And you know that you have power and authority and are ready to embrace the process when his thoughts become your thoughts, when his words become your words, when what breaks his heart breaks your heart. You've got to understand that God has powerful thoughts of you. As much as you can think of yourself, God thinks that and then some in your life. But you've got to embrace his power and embrace the process. The more we listen to God and diligently seek him, the more we'll be able to bring his thoughts into reality. In God's thoughts are his strategy. His strategy reveals his strength. And in his strength, you'll find his power, and the authority to utilize the power comes through your process. Understand, your process is simply the vehicle to get you to your destiny, nothing more. The process is not there to kill you. The process is not there to destroy you. The process is not there for you to look bad, but you must endure the process, because in the process, you will find how anointed you really are. You can walk around talking about how anointed you are, but you don't really know how anointed you are until that anointing meets up with God's process. The process is likened unto a journey where you find yourself. A person that has found themselves is impossible to defeat. A person that knows who they are is impossible to detour. A person that understands who God is in them is impossible to detain. That sooner or later they will break out of the shell and do what God has called for them to do. They will be relentless in their tenacity and protect the person that they are becoming instead of protecting the person that you have made them to be. Oftentimes, beloved, we spend a lot of time time crying over wasted time. A lot of time, oftentimes, my brothers and sisters, we spend a lot of time trying to protect who people have made us to be. But once you get free from people's thoughts and opinions about who you are ready for real power. Once you get free from people's proclivities about you and their thought patterns of who you are, sometimes we defend who people have made us to be. You've got to stop defending who people made you to be. Find out who you really are and walk into the realms that God has called you to walk in. You will not know freedom until you get free from people. Number three, power reveals conflict. The one thing that is remembered about the Exodus from Egypt is the conflict. Now watch this, beloved. This is really particular because we rejoice in their conflict but reject our own conflict. We rejoice in the fact that they went through the Red Sea, but we reject the fact that we have to go through a Red Sea. Oh my God. Understand this. There will be no promised land without problems landing first. Now say that again. There will be no promised land without problems landing first. That you will go to the promised land through your problems landing before the promised land. Stop thinking something is wrong because there's conflict. There's supposed to be conflict. There's supposed to be trials. So can you imagine living a life without ever having something to buffet you to understand how powerful you really are? Then you'll walk around professing how much anointing you have, how much power you have, and then you'll start degrading people that are going through. Your go-through is as anointed as you speaking in tongues. Your go-through is as anointed as any sermon you can preach. Your go-through is as anointed as any song that you can sing. Because you will never realize how much power you have until you've gone through something. People that have gone through something can stand up and affirm who they are and understand that the same God that brought them to it is the same God that will take them through it. Your go-through, beloved, is anointed. Oh, your go-through has been employed by God. You know the Bible says all things work together for the good of them that love God, to those that are called according to his purpose. When you quote that, the next time you quote that, understand that your go-through is a part of God's purpose. Your go-through has been employed by God to get you through. That's why it's called your go-through. It's not called your stay there. It's called your go-through. And when you get through your go-through, you will understand that if it had not been for the Lord that was on your side, you would have been swallowed up a long time ago, but you understand your power will reveal the conflict and has always been there. Understand, beloved, that if it were easy, anybody could do it. God doesn't give out easy assignments. But the assignment God gives you is something you cannot get done without him stepping up and stepping in your life. Assignment that God gives you is not something your neighbor can do, not something your prayer partner can do. It's not something they will even understand all the time. But you got to understand, God does not give his strongest soldiers easy assignments. So if you have a difficult assignment, if you have a difficult go-through, then you're going to have a powerful breakthrough. Your go-through, the fervency of your go-through dictates the power of your breakthrough. If you're going through something really rough right now, then your breakthrough is going to be really tough when you get there. That your go-through, as far as you go down, is as high as you're going to go up. So don't be mad when the elevator's going downhill. Just keep talking junk while you're going downstairs. While the elevator's going down in your life, you got to learn how to talk on the way down so you can say the same thing on the way up. On the way down, you've got to say, well, God is still a provider. On the way down, you've got to say, well, God is still a way maker. On the way down, you've got to say, God is still a healer. My God is going to supply all my needs. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor the seed begging bread. God is still my shekable, my source. God is still my strength. God is my buckler. God is my shield. God is my power. On the way down, you got to still declare the word of God according to the will of God. You got to learn how to speak life until you see life. Don't wait until the elevator goes up, because the power comes on the way down. On the way up, you're just getting used to the authority, but on the way down, you got to speak life even while your life is tail spinning out of control. If you can learn this principle, beloved, you will begin to see a modicum of power to begin to rise up in your spirit. It's not about on the mountaintop. Everybody's anointed on the mountaintop. Everybody's blessed on the mountaintop. Everybody looks like they got it going on the mountaintop, but you've got to sit down and have a talk with them. Before you get too attracted to the glory, sit down and learn their story. Before you get too attracted to where they are now, learn about where they were then. And they will tell you times got rough. They will tell you there were times when I didn't know if I was going to make it. They will tell you there were times I threw in the towel, but God threw it back at me and told me, wipe your face, boy. I got something better for you. Understand that it's not about the mountaintop. It's about the valley low where you are anointed. And your anointing resides within the conflict. Now, the enemy doesn't bother you as long as you're in bondage and thinking like a slave. He didn't mind the children of Israel weren't worshiping in the wilderness. He didn't mind them building the kingdom for the Egyptians. But as soon as they stepped outside of where he said that Pharaoh said that they could go, he launched an all-out attack to get them back. Watch this, because when God brings you out, he brings you all the way out. Before he brought them out of Egypt, he told them to go and borrow gold and silver, go borrow vessels and borrow not a few. They borrowed so much, and the borrow merely means they took the stuff that they went and got the gold and the silver, and they exodused out of Egypt. They had so much until they loaded their donkeys down. They had wealth on their children's back. They had wealth on their parents' back. I better not get into this, but I'm going to say this before I move on. But I'm going to get too deep. That when I see what God did to the children of Israel in their exodus from Egypt, how he precluded slavery, he precluded their slavery mentality with giving them wealth and riches and having them walk on dry land, I see what God is about to do to the church. I see what God is about to do to my babies. I see what God is about to do to your babies. Is that when we come out, we're going to come out with more than what we went in with. We went into being sheltered in place, being hurt and busted and disgusted about that old devil shutting the doors of the church. But I come to update the files in that God wanted us to shelter ourselves in place, put blood on the lintels, and God was doing a work. And while we were here sheltered in place, God was giving us riches, not physical riches, but spiritual riches, that when we come out, the fervency of our praise is actually going to reach heaven. When we come out, our prophecies are actually going to be on point. When we come out, we're not going to talk about houses, cars, and lands. And we're not going to be prophesying sickness on folk. We're not going to be prophesying physical blessings on people. In fact, we're not going to be prophesying to people. We're going to prophesy to the altar. Oh, my God. And say, if you want this word, bring your hips down to the altar. That the altar is going to be the place where prophecies are birthed. At the altar are the midwives. At the altar is the woman with the towel and the water ready to birth that prophecy out of you. Everybody thinks they can get what they want by watching it on Facebook or by sitting in the back pew. But God is saying, I'm drawing you from the background to the front. And when we prophesy, when we praise, when we worship, things are actually going to happen because we have been sheltered in a place where God is refilling us with his anointing and with his power and with his authority. God has authorized the church to step into a new realm of glory. Oh my goodness. God has authorized the church that we are now on another level. We've been saying it for years. We're going to another level. I'm going, the church is going to another level. We said it and then we read the announcements. We said the church is going to another level and then we announced about the chicken frying club and the usher committee and all of these things, and God said, that ain't another level. That's the level that you're on now. So God says, I'm taking you to another level. But watch this. In order to get to that next next level, you got to stop sometimes and address what's really going on. So now God has authorized, he has already signed the document. He has already released the stimulus. He has already accepted what was going on and said, now you are authorized to walk on a level that you have been talking about for years. The church has become the equivalent to the children of Israel serving Egypt. They were powerful in Egypt, but they were building kingdoms for Egypt and not for God. They were building kingdoms and not people. The economy of the church has taken over the ecology of the church. That we sometimes are worried more about the economy of the church than we are the ecology of the church. The ecology of the church dictates that we love our brothers and sisters more than we love the building. That we love our relationship with those around us more than we love the padded pews or the AC or the bank account or the building fund or the designated and undesignated money. That God said, take your mind off of the money. Put your mind on your brother that's hurting beside you. Put your mind on the sister that's busted and broken beside you. But God is bringing us back to the ecology of the church over the economy. The economy is going to take care of itself. If the believers tithe and pay offering, then that'll take care of itself. But God is saying, I need you to take care of your brothers and your sisters in the ecology of the church and understand that conflict will happen. For the most part, beloved, the church has escaped real conflict. The church in the United States have escaped real conflict. Let me show you something real quick. Christians are being persecuted all over the world. All over the world, they're being persecuted. But in the United States, we have a modicum of peace and we have levity and brevity in the way that we worship. Approximately 100,000 Christians are being killed annually across the globe because of what they believe in. About 200 million Christians are allegedly under assault even now. Every year, there's a Christian nonprofit organization called Open Doors, and they publish the World Watch List. It's a list of the top 50 countries which it designates that as the most dangerous place for Christians to be. In 2019, the watch list was as follows. North Korea was on number one, and they have communist oppression against the 300,000 believers that stay there. Afghanistan was number two on the list, and they have Islamic oppression, that there are approximately thousands of believers there. Number three is Somalia. There's Islamic oppression there. There's only a few hundred believers there. Number four is Libya. Islamic oppression against 37,000 believers over there. Pakistan, Islamic oppression over 3 million believers. Sudan has Islamic oppression over 1 million. Eritrea has a dictatorial paranoia against about 300,000 believers. Yemen has Islamic oppression against a few thousand believers. Iran has Islamic oppression against 800,000 believers. And India, number 10 on the list as of 2019, believes in religious nationalism, and they have 65 million believers that are being persecuted. So over here, we are not facing persecution. And when I say Islamic oppression and religious nationalism, they are actually being carted off to jail. They're actually being killed. They're actually being put in lines and shot and necks cut off for what they believe in. So what we're facing over here is not oppression or anything at all. We have the right to do what we want to do, but there is, can I tell you this, because there's coming a time to where the United States is going to have to pony up. There's coming a time where the United States is going to have to pony up and actually fight for what we believe in. We got it good now, but don't let the good times fool you, because God has released us to another level, but with another level comes conflict, and conflict is going to hit this place like never before. Right now, they are lining up, oh my God, they are lining up things to cause Christianity to be just another religion. If I had time, I'd walk you through the court cases that actually started in the early 1900s up until now, where they have been setting precedents. They have been setting precedents to cause the church to be just another entity. Don't let the good times fool you, beloved. Don't let the good times fool you. They are setting up precedents. They started with the religious system. Then they went to the school system. Then they're going to our personal lives. The next attack is going to be on church. They have laws and things that have been passed while you're worried about what color the dress is on Facebook, while you're worried about the strategic placing of news media on Facebook, while you're worried about cops killing black folks, or while you're worried about what happened over here in Queen Diana and all these different things, while you're being distracted by the fake news, as Trump calls it, that there are laws being passed that directly affect the way that we believe and the way that we worship. Did you not know that it's not legal to teach Christianity in school unless you can also teach evolution? You cannot teach Christianity in schools unless you can also teach Satanism. That they've blocked us from being able to say that God is the only way. Took the Ten Commandments out of the chamber. Made a homosexuality and lesbianism, put it on the same plan as the plan of God. They are strategically placing things in the path of the church to where now every church in America has had to rewrite their bylaws. We have to rewrite what it is that we have stated we believe in, because the time changed right before our very eyes. Caught everybody by surprise, and now we have to revamp, recalculate the way we even worship God. We can't go back into the same thing that we left. I promise you, if you and your ministry or our ministry goes back to the way things were, something's going to happen, because God has already spoken. I'm not talking about death on a church member or anything, but something's going to happen to awaken and arouse that church to where God has already spoken. God has already pulled the scales off of our eyes. God has sent prophets and preachers and teachers forward to warn us of the impending danger, to warn us not to be distracted by things that are going on, to warn us to not be distracted by the fake news. It's not designed for us to follow the news on every turn. Every cause is not our cause. We take up causes because we believe in it, but sometimes the cause you're taking up should be a cause you take up for Christ. And I know I'm going to catch slack for this, but I got the mic, so I'm going to say it anyway. As many people that walk for the young man that just got shot, you ought to get your hips right back on the street, log back on the Facebook Live, and walk for the sake of Jesus Christ that got hung on an old rugged cross. I know you want that cause. I know you like that cause, and I'm not saying you shouldn't have walk for that cause. What I am saying is that as much power and as much attention that you put in on that cause, have that same energy when it comes to representing Jesus Christ. I need to see some people log on and say, I'm going to walk 2,000 miles, because over 2,000 years ago, I know a man named Jesus. I know a man that died on an old rugged cross. I represent this young man because I feel what is going on, but I have a Savior that I need to represent. I know I got to represent him. So that same energy, use it to represent Jesus Christ. Use it to represent your Lord and Savior. Use it to represent who he is and what he has done. Every cause is not for the church. Every cause is not for us to fight. And I don't mind if you fight a cause that is good, because I fight for causes too. But let the cause of your hope, of your calling, let the cause of what Jesus did for you shine just as bright as any other cause that you can give. And I know I'm about to start losing folks, but that's just the way that I see it. That we have a cause that we should represent every single day, because there's a precedence being set while we're following every news feed, while we're following everything that goes on. There's a precedence being set behind closed doors. There is a new world order that has been in place since the 60s, and the only reason why they haven't fully pulled the trigger on it is because they don't have full acceptance from the church yet. There is a pocket of resistance against the mark of the beast and the number in his name. thing. And as long as there is a pocket of resistance, it doesn't matter how many 5G towers they put up. It doesn't matter how many AI robots they make. It doesn't matter how much tracking technology they put in place. It doesn't matter how much fake news they put out. It doesn't matter how many pandemics or epidemics or organized chaos that is put in the world. There is a pocket, a remnant of believers that will simply refuse to let everything be what it is. And all I'm saying is that there is a precedence being set. While we are watching what's going on, there's something behind closed doors. Did you not know, and I'm going to move on, praise God. Did you not know that the most important votes that you could cast are for on the local level? You are to vote for the president, but you should also vote for here people on the local level. Those votes are just as, if not more important than the president of the United States. But the news media will tell you that it's your right and you should vote for the president. That is true. But what they don't tell you is that the real power of change comes from the governors. The real power of change comes from the mayors, comes from those that are on the local level. The real power to effect change where you are comes on the local level, not necessarily on that high level. You see, beloved, it's not enough just to have a vision. You don't coordinate it with what's in your hands. And my next point, power sets precedence. So the Lord said unto Moses, why are you crying to me? Speak to the children of Israel that they go forward. But lift up your rod and stretch it out over the sea. He was telling Moses in this time, coordinate with what's in your hand with what's in your heart. After you coordinate it, stretch it forward and watch God move. Why, beloved? Because faith without works is dead, being alone. There are some things that God is requiring from you in the coming days that is going to require from you in the coming weeks and months that's going to be a stretch for you. It's going to be more than what you thought you could handle. It's going to be a stretch for you to do the will of God. So watch this. When Moses coordinated what was in his hands with what was in his heart, he did something that had never been done before. He stretched out his rod toward the Red Sea, and for the first time, he walked in a place where no one has ever walked before. Wow, my God, this is good. He walked on the floor bed of the Red Sea. Nobody had ever walked on that particular ground before Moses stretched himself. And watch this. He didn't just walk on the floor of the Red Sea. Everybody following him walked on that same floor. And God parted the sea so good until they walked on dry ground. He understood they had so much riches on their back that they couldn't trek through the mud. So God dried the ground up, and now they have a wall of sea on the left and the right, and they have set precedent of a whole nation walking in a place that has never been walked on before. What are you saying, Reverend Shy? That there is a realm of glory that this church is about to walk in. There is a realm of glory that the remnant church is about to walk in. God is about to cause this church to walk in a place that our mothers and our fathers and our forefathers only prayed about. They shouted about the promise, but you are the results of that shout. You are the results of that prayer. We've been saying for a long time going to another level, but I declare it this morning in the name of Jesus by the power and authority of the Holy Ghost that God has authorized us to walk in a realm that has never been walked on before. If you stretch yourself, if you stretch out on faith, if you stretch out and hold out, God is going to cause you to walk in a place where your bank account don't say you should be there. Your education won't dictate you can be there. They have more on their resume than you, but you have more God in your spirit than them. God is about to escalate. He's about to escalate glory. He's about to escalate glory in your life. He's about to escalate favor in your life. There is an acceleration of what God wants to do because he has authorized you to walk in another level. Please don't leave this life walking in the same place before you got on. Please don't leave this sheltered in place walking on the same level before we sheltered in place. There is a modicum of power that is in your spirit. You got to speak it to release it. You got to stretch out to make it come to pass. And the church has been authorized to go to the next level. There's a realm of glory that is unparalleled, unprecedented. by any of your peers. There is a realm of glory, beloved, that God is saying, walk in. He's saying, gird up the loins of your mind and walk in it. We rejoice about what the children of Israel went through. Then we get mad about what we have to go through. But they would not have known the power of the promised land except they went through the problem at the Red Sea. So there's a realm of glory that God is about to cause the people of God to walk in. I don't know who you are. I don't know who this is for. But God told me to tell you, you have been authorized. God has already signed it. Welcome to the next level. Welcome to the next level. The reason we have not been able to walk in it because we view the next level as God giving us more physically. But the next level, the next dimension, the next realm is God loading you up spiritually. In this place, God has loaded some people up spiritually and they are walking on the next level. They are walking in another place. They are walking in a place to where others have only dreamed about. Now watch this. You may not receive the endorsement or the support of the status quo, the good old boys, the people that are set in place now. But I told you a couple of weeks ago, the same God that elevated you is the same God that's doing the hiring and the firing. All you have to do is be patient and wait for your time of ministry because God has authorized you to level up to the next place in glory. That when we leave, don't leave. Don't go back to church in the same place. Don't go back to church and sit on that same pew. Don't go back to church and barely get in the service. Don't go back to church and say, well, I've been here 20 years. I'm just going to be. Don't go back to church thinking that you own the church. Don't go back to church thinking that it can't go on without you. Don't go back to church thinking that that church don't start till you get there. Don't go back to church thinking it's all about you, but go back to church being a giver. Go back to church being a lender. Go back to church thinking about somebody else other than yourself and watch God elevate you to the next level. And my last point, God will close the door. God is closing the door. For some of you, you don't have an option to go back to what it used to be. No matter how much you're going to try, no matter how much you're going to try to settle in to where it was, once you put one foot on the Red Sea floor bed, God closes the door behind you to where even if you try to go back to the way that it was, God is going to cause restless nights to be in your life. You're going to think, oh God, I got insomnia. No, it ain't insomnia, baby. It's God not letting you rest in your mess. God is saying, I've invested too much in you. I've poured too much water in your life to let you rest in this mess. I pour too much of you for you to sit there and not get no word. I pour too much of you for you to sit there and not get full or not. God, I pour too much in you for you to just sit on that anointing. I pour too much in you. And God is going to close the door behind you. Once you step foot in the Red Sea, babe, now before you ascribe to be free, understand that freedom ain't free. Good God Almighty. Freedom ain't free. It's free to get, but it costs you everything to walk in. To walk into true liberty, you've got to give up on some things. You've got to give up on your comfort zone. You've got to give up on your favorite television show. You've got to give up on your free time. Put more time in what God has told you to do. There are entrepreneurs on this line. There are praise worshipers on this line. There are book writers on this line. There are preachers and there are preachers and prophets on this line. There are people that God has authorized you to go to the next level, but you have got to count up the cost and ask yourself, am I ready and willing to suffer for what God has called me to do? This next level is not for the weak. This next level is not for the watchers. This next level is for the worshipers. Ooh, I got to get out of here. This next level is only for the worshipers, only for those that are willing to put skin in the game, only for those those that are willing to walk through a Red Sea, send water on the right and water on the left, and say, God, you got this, so I'm going anywhere. This is for those that are willing to walk in dangerous deliverance, and deliverance that's so dangerous until you are exposed to the public. And when you are exposed, you say, well, I can't go back there. Mm. So God is trying to expose your anointing. He's trying to expose your calling. He's trying to expose the fervency of what he's called you to do. And when God exposes you, you can't go back to where you used to be, because people are depending on you to walk in what God has called you to do. And in order for God to get some of us to walk in what he's called us to do, he's got to close the door behind us. I knew he had to close the door for me, because if he hadn't closed the door for me, I'd have gone right back to where I used to be, because when I walked in church, I didn't look like anybody else. I didn't talk like anybody else. I didn't act like anybody else. But God said, you are meant to be here. This is something that I need. So where I used to be, he wouldn't allow me to go. What I used to do, he wouldn't allow me to do. And he closed the door behind me so that I wouldn't go back to him. Some of you on this line today, God, even at, oh, second of the bush, I see it as I speak. God is closing the door behind you. He's shutting the door to your past. He's closing the door on that pain. He's closing the door on that problem. He's closing the door on who you used to be. He's closing the door on the name they called you. He's closing the door. You've been knocking on the door trying to get in. God has said, stop knocking on doors. Just sit still for a moment. Since that's the purpose of what we're going through, sit still for a moment so God can do his work. He that hath begun a good work in you is going to complete it. So what he's doing now, did you not know he's not just the God that opens doors? He's the same God that opens doors, is the God that closes doors. The doors behind you are slamming shut right now. They're closing even now. You're going to try to go back to him, but it ain't going to taste the same. It ain't going to feel the same. He ain't even going to look the same. She's not going to have the same swag or savor, because God has closed that door. And in order for you to know that he closed the door, you got to go check it one more time. Have you ever pulled on the door two or three times just to make sure that the door was locked? You're going to pull on that door a couple of times, and God's going to reaffirm and recommit you to, yeah, I closed that door. Turn back around. Don't look back. Walk forward. Because if the children of Israel had turned around in the Red Sea, that wall would have collapsed. It was the wind, the east wind, that held the Red Sea open. The same wind that caused the waters to assuage in Genesis. That same wind that Ezekiel spoke in the Valley of Dry Bones. That same wind now is holding the Red Sea. But watch this. The wind parted the sea, but your faith is going to keep it open. Your faith is going to keep it until you get to the other side of what God has said you can already have. Mm. And when they got to the other side, they raised a praise because they resisted the problem. When we get to the other side, when we get back into the doors of the church, when they lift the order and we can go back and shake hands and talk and sing praises unto God, when we get back to the other side, there ought to be a praise so loud. There ought to be a praise so fervent. There ought to be a praise so powerful. There ought to be a praise so strong. There ought to be a praise that just won't keep its peace. Some of you have a sheltered in place praise, but when you get to the other side of the Red Sea, we've got to do like Miriam and the children of Israel and get together and sing a new song. When God makes a way for you and you get out of it, you've got to sing a new song. The whole purpose of this is for the church to sing a new song, to do a new thing. The doors of the church is closed until further notification. The church is closed for renovation. The church is closed until we get to a place where we know we're the church and we gather together and we ought to raise a praise so strong. We ought to raise a praise so powerful, unshakable. We ought to raise a praise so fervent that if the preacher gets to preach, good God, that if he gets, I know I'm going to praise God. When I get back to church, I'm going to praise. I praise him now, so it ain't going to be no problem when I go back. But I've seen God. I've heard God's voice. I understand what God is doing. I understand this is not of the devil. I know the coronavirus is bad and God doesn't send sickness, but God authorized this to wake us up. He authorized this because people are dying overseas and we are comfortable and complacent in America. We have the power to affect change, but we can't affect change if we think it's all about us. So God, and understand this, that the coronavirus in its current state and form is only one thing that is passing through. There's something else coming, then there's something else coming. But one thing about trials and tribulations, and after you've been there and done that, you see it the next time and you understand what God wants the next time the next thing hits. So the church has been released into a realm of power, a realm of glory. Watch this, individually and corporately. And God is closing the doors. Yep. He's closing the doors. He's closing the doors behind you. He's closing the doors. And because you dared tell God yes, because you put one foot in the Red Sea, understand, Pharaoh sent 600 of his choicest chariots behind the children of Israel because they dared to walk in a place he didn't authorize. For years, we've been going to church, but the devil been going too. For years, we have been proclaiming something and the devil's been sitting right there. He's gotten so bold until he stopped sitting there. He started ministering in church. I know y'all don't believe me, but the devil has actually started singing, preaching, ushering, prophesying in church because we've made him so comfortable there. We made him so comfortable in church until we've actually helped the push of the Antichrist system and move to be in church. God saw the downward spiral and said, I've got to take a church out of church and then put them back in church. He said, I had to take the church out of church so that I could put them back into church. Because in order for God to clean house, he's got to expose the devil for who he is. So when we go back, I know you got a voice like no other, but it's just talent till you bring your hips down to the altar and get delivered. I know you can play without learning music and playing 10 keys, but it's just talent till you get your hips down to the altar and get delivered. I know you want to help and serve, but you can't serve in a place where you don't know the God over the place. Preachers have got hard decisions to make when we go back. Are we going to continue in a place knowing that choir director ain't living right? Are we going to go back to the place knowing he just played in the club Friday and she just shook her tail in the club Saturday and allowed them to minister? Because a house divided against itself cannot stand. So God says, I had to take a church out of church so that I could put them back into church. We're going back to the place where it's holiness or hell. Get right or get left. Talent is not enough. I can turn on the radio and hear talent. I can go to a concert and hear talent. But God is saying on this new level, he is authorized only the anointed. Only the anointed. Only the anointed are going to be allowed to work. And that may dwindle down numbers. That may dwindle down tithes and offering. But would you rather have a church full of money or a church full of momentum? Only those that are righteous shall see God. Now, the church is a hospital bed for sinners. But we should not allow those that don't know God, just because they're talented, just because they have money, just because they have prominence and prestige, to yoke up the church of the living God. Because after warning comes judgment. After the warning, after the prodding, after the preaching, after the teaching, after the pleading, comes judgment. So when God closed the door behind us, we've got to go with reckless abandonment toward what he says. Because the enemy behind you, he's not just closing the door on you, he's closing the door on the enemy that was behind you. And he's going to give you the power to go along with the, or he's going to give you the authority to go along with that power. He's going to give you the authority to walk and talk, and it means something. He's going to give you the authority to speak it. And don't worry about where you've been. Don't worry about who you've been. God is raising up no names in this day and time, because it ain't about your name. If you're in it for the prominence and the prestige and the money, don't even worry about it. Don't even worry about it. It's not about your name. It's not about followers or likes. It's not about people knowing who you are. God is raising up a people that's going to elevate and escalate his will and his purpose. Beloved, I believe I've done it. I believe I've said what he's told me to say. But understand this. We are going from wilderness and to worship. And for some of you, you've got to bear down and birth this prophecy. You got to bear down and birth this promise in your belly. You got to bear down and birth. You got to endure the pain and birth it. Because when we come out of this place, all hands on deck. When we come out of this place, it's time to go to work. It's time to really worship him for real this time. And we have got to stop making excuses for the devil sitting and working and being comfortable in church. All right. He's taken us somewhere. You are anointed for this. You have power. You have authority. Now use it. Use it. Walk in it like you already know it's there. Don't worry about it. Just try it. Just walk in it. Just walk in it. Walk in it like you're already there. Walk in it. Walk in it. God's giving you visions and dreams. They mean something in this day. Every visionary, every dreamer, your dreams mean something. Your dreams mean something. You have a thought for that business idea. You have a thought for working in another place in church. God, it means something. It means something. There is a protocol. There is a process. But what God is revealing to you in this time means something. It means something. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for what you've said. We thank you for what you have imparted into our lives. Lord, we ask you to help us. Help us, dear God. Move in a mighty way in this new place you've authorized for us. Help us, Father God. Give us the tenacity. Give us the unction to move by your Holy Spirit. Let your perfect, honest, and holy will be done. From the crown of our heads to the sole of our very feet. Father God, when we go back into the church building, meet us there, God. Meet us there. And while you're giving us the strategies now, Father God, make it easy to convey your vision. Make it easy to convey your vision to the people, and help us to, on one accord, agree and walk in what it is that you've called for us to do, Father God. No more church as normal. There is a new normal. No more church as usual. Help us to walk in this place, Father God. Make it normal for us in our minds, even now as we pray. So when we go out, it's not a stretch, it's not a strain to do what you've called for us to do. There's a multitude of people to reach. There's a multitude of people that just needs to hear that you love them, that you care for them. There's a multitude of family members that need us to step up and tell them that you love them and you care for them. People are suffering all over the world, but we're able to go to and fro freely to disseminate the gospel. Help us to appreciate that. And as we ascend to this new place, God, let your anointing fall fresh in the name of Jesus. Let your anointing fall fresh for every heart, every mind, and every spirit, God, that we all go back bringing something to the table. Oh, God, we thank you and we give you glory, honor, and praise because you alone are worthy. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. I love you. Until next time. Till next time. Shalom.